Well, good morning. Welcome to my new world. After 5 years in Palo Alto, I was starting to feel a little hemmed in and needed some air. And we started exploring where that might be. And this is my new innovation lab. This is what I wake up to. And I have to say it's been an incredibly inspiring place. In fact, right out the door here, it's also called the Valley of the Moon. And there's a reason for that, because the moon looks so close to you, you swear you could touch it. And the stars are so bright, it's like you're in a planetarium. So it is an amazing place to be inspired, and I hope you get a chance, maybe a few wineries, but you get a chance to explore, because it is a very, very special place. My team likes to call it City Ventures North. All kidding aside, but the reality is, we do our best work up here, because we get out of even our kind of cool space and really sit and ponder and reflect about where we have been and where we are going. So one day, about a couple weeks ago, I started getting up on the board, because believe it or not, in May, I will have been doing this 8 years. I've never done anything the same for 8 years, ever, and it's kind of extraordinary. So if you go to the next chart, don't worry, I'm not going to take you through this, but this was an actual exercise. And once I started, my team said, keep going. And it was extremely informative, because I was the first CIO of Citi in 2008. And by the way, nobody was even called a chief innovation officer then. It was a big deal. Remember Heidi? I mean, it was a big deal. We had a big conversation about it. And then 3 months later, Lehman fell, and the whole world blew up. And then they told us, go underground. And we did. And we did a lot of really cool things. And we started actually doing the innovation. We did mobile money ventures and did mobile banking way before others with South Korea Telecom. We did a lot of very, very interesting projects. But it was also a very interesting time, because it was so early that what we ran smack into was not invented here. So some of our very best work got sold, and sometimes to competitors. So it's not easy in those early days. But in 2010, I said, you know what? We need to come out here. And that was the game changer. And it's been extraordinary. In fact, Wendell and I were talking this morning, and Heidi will remember, and I saw Patty out there. In the early days, when you get here, it's like your brain is on fire. It's so exciting to really be freed of that corporate kind of culture, and just to be in the middle of this. And I always say, when I'm having a frustrating day with New York, I meet with three startups and I feel inspired all over again. And it's really, really true. So, I mean, that was really extraordinary. And then as we moved in our work, we survived, very big deal, a change in CEO. As you know, that's often when corporate venturing dies, when there's a change in power. And in fact, they tell the story, they came out to visit us to tell us we were being closed. And we're very proud of the fact that at the end of the day, they said, oh my God, we had no idea what was going on out here. So that was kind of cool. So I call that the near-death experience. And you can see all the investments we were making as we went through this. And we really pressed, though, and started understanding. We've moved from being the innovators to really then starting to bring design thinking to the table and helping businesses kind of redesign themselves. But even that, we recognized, didn't scale. And so where we have moved to and what is happening now is we're driving capabilities. And the same thing is, we've really moved the conversation and started with our first Silicon Valley Summit that completely changed the dialogue with leadership. But we stopped talking about innovation, and we started talking about growth. That sounds obvious now, but a couple years ago, it wasn't so obvious. And we really began that dialogue and really recognized, and we, in fact, renamed it and said, this is really about discovery. And so it's been a very, very interesting journey now to really be focusing on, we all know innovation, not at scale, is nothing better than a hobby. So how do you scale in a massive global company? And that's what we're in the midst of doing. So our model has completely evolved. We were pivoting before Eric Ries started talking about pivoting, because you have to. You have to stay relevant. And I'm sure all of you have been through that. But, you know, we've been equity investing from the beginning with professional former VCs. And it's been an extraordinary ride. We are champions of the entrepreneur. We drive for commercialization. It's not a requirement, but it's a big part of what we do. And it's been really a fantastic. We've just landed some people in New York, and we're considering other locales. As you know, James was saying, it's just changing the game. And you know, we also then created this lab network, which is part of what we call new skills and new ways of working. We connected all the labs in the company. We don't own the labs, but we created a common language, a portfolio process, and we have an acceleration fund where we can speed things up in the lab. And the latest thing now is driving, a la Eric Ries and David Kidder at Bionic, the whole concept of really embracing, you know, the lean enterprise and entrepreneurship as a new form of management to really drive a growth capability. It's been a hell of a ride. And there are many days where you have to wonder, like, why am I doing this? And James, I think, kind of threw out the phrase that we always make fun of in the show in Silicon Valley on HBO. But it's like, you know, we want to make the world a better place. But the reality is, when you're in this kind of work, you have to believe that. You do have to believe that, because it's tough. And, you know, the last part of this is this year moving up to San Francisco, because the whole world has moved to San Francisco. So it's going to be an interesting time. But what I really want to say, at the end of the day, we have to understand that we are nothing but a very significant Trojan horse inside of our companies, because it's really about culture change. You can never call it out that way, but that is really what's happening. And even in just the past few years, you've seen this speed start rumbling. And you know, every time I catch up with Heidi, she said, "Where are you?" I said, "I don't even know what city I'm in," because the intent and the demand for what we're trying to do has gone up so much. But the reality is, I think the people in this room are upending very long-held beliefs in our companies, particularly in our industry. But I think it holds true across everybody in this room, that we're moving from we always know the answer to let's create a hypothesis, let's experiment, and let's go validate, from really thinking about we have a really known set of really competitors. Now we have the wild west of these crazy disruptive startups that are breaking through in an industry that always said the barriers to entry are so high, it'll never happen. It's happening, and it's significant. So the requirement of all that is really what we call new skills and new ways of working, is you really are trying to bring to an organization how to change their thinking, because this is against a backdrop that all of us are living. With technology is spinning faster and faster, the costs are going down, which is part of the barriers to entry coming down. We're watching the bottom of the stack be commoditized, the democratization of access. There's a lot going on. And the customer, by the way, whether it's a corporate client or a customer, is king and is demanding extraordinary UX and simplicity and really, really beautiful ways of understanding them and what's important in their life. Oh, and then let's just add the whole macro background. So think about macroeconomics, politics, I'm not even going there, you know, the social side, the environment. As Tim Geithner said, you know, we live in a dark, messy, scary, uncertain world. And that's really true. So the net of all that is growth that's elusive. So I think we're into this little thing with rocks and plants growing up. I don't know, it might have lived its worth here, but just stay with me. Because this is what it takes to do the kind of things we're trying to create. To change a culture, to be able to say, it's not about going from big to bigger, it's about going from new to big. And where's Sue Siegel I saw earlier? Where is she? Over here somewhere. There she is. And Sue's team is very involved in the same kind of, I'm using language I'm sure she recognizes. And it's so true, because going from new to big really requires different muscles. So for all of us, it is this intense bringing the outside in. I think all of you are focused on that. Extreme focus. You can't play hobbies. Don't get distracted. Stay true. Trust your gut. And know, because you're searching for relevance. And it's when you get leadership and you watch them, looking at Claudia, you know, when you see them say, okay, I get it now. and you see that light go on, you got to keep going. You got to keep charging. And you got to keep moving, because the window will only stay open for so long. You got to also build creative confidence. And this is hard, because people say, I'm not Steve Jobs. I can't do this work. And so you have to build that capability. And that's why I said that we are very focused on scaling globally new capabilities and creating growth. And you have to embed it in the business, which I think has been the real flip that we have done. Is a lot of the work we're doing is being owned by our business unit CEOs and embraced, and they're starting to help drive the change in thinking. It is about a new mindset. And the only way you're going to win is to scale it. And it's heavy lifting, I have to say. And as I mentioned, this speed thing, I just feel even in the last year, it's just so hard to recognize how fast disruption is happening and how fast our corporate cultures have to dramatically change. And you know, the work that we do, you have to be passionate, you have to be courageous, you have to push, you have to know maybe when to stop pushing, you have to keep looking for ways to really be relevant. And Beth Comstock, who's just become the most phenomenal rock star, makes my heart so happy. The other day said, and you got to be a little paranoid. And it's true, because you're just waiting for who's going to try and kill you next, right? But you have to be resilient. You're going to get kicked down, and you get yourself back up. And that is what really this game is about. But it's worth it, because it's so exciting to see what can happen. And above all, you have to have a little fun. So I have a little motto. Refuse to be normal.
Normal. Normal is regular. Average. Medium. Normal is safe. Familiar. Warm and comfortable. Normal is the thing you know. It is what is. But normal isn't great. Normal isn't fantastic. Normal can never be amazing.
It makes me so happy, but it's how I feel. Now, I'm super excited to hand off to somebody I think you're all really, really waiting to hear from, Wendell Brooks. And it's kind of extraordinary, you know, when you walk into I love those silly, you know, cliches, but big shoes to fill and all. God, he's probably heard it all 500 times, right? But it is historic, because we're watching, you know, Arvin, who... We're here because of Arvin, and that is extraordinary. And 35 years at Intel driving so many things that have been really foundational for the work we get to do. And so for Wendell to step into that is a big deal. And you know, one of the things, we had a really fun meeting, we have a lot in common. Turns out we both grew up in Michigan. Turns out we are both really passionate car guys, which is cool. We're both frustrated engineers. Former bankers, we don't talk about that too much, but done a few IPOs in our day. And we both used to work for Citi. So it's been really interesting. But wow, the greatest chapter for him is coming now. And I think, in case you're wondering if it's, you know, going to be a little hard for him, forget that. He's already changing the business model. So, Wendell?